Brachial plexus anatomy is too complex and boring to remember. If you feel so, let's learn the structural, functional, topographical, surgical, and clinical anatomy of the brachial plexus in an integrated fashion with reconstructive perspective in mind. Hi, this is Dave from PlaRecon. Let's start off by quickly drawing a brachial plexus using the mnemonic 3 Ys, a cross, an oblique line, and a tick. So this is the first Y, the second Y is reversed, this is the third Y, here comes the cross, the oblique line, and the tick. It's that simple. Coming to the parts, this is the first part, the second part, the third part, the fourth part, and the terminal part. Now coming to the side branches, the first part has 2 side branches, the second part has 2 again, the third part has none, and the fourth part has 7 branches. That's 11 side branches in total. So here's a better version of the same 3Y cross oblique tick line diagram with its 5 parts, which are roots, trunks, divisions, cords, and the 5 terminal branches. There are various cold bear mnemonics to remember this order, but it's much simpler to just remember a tree with its roots, the trunk, and finally the branches. But then how do we remember the cords and the divisions? Well, from distal to proximal, they are arranged in the alphabetical order. Moving on to further details of each of the 5 parts of the brachial plexus and their side branches, on the right we can see the color-coded version of the same line diagram, and on the left a representative brachial plexus illustration. Starting off with the roots of the brachial plexus, which lie in the interscalene triangle. They are formed by the ventral rami of C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1 spinal nerves. When the ventral rami of C4 spinal nerve contributes to the brachial plexus, it's called prefixed brachial plexus. Whereas when there is contribution from T2, it's called postfixed. The incidence of prefixed and postfixed can be easily remembered as around 20-50% for prefixed and 2-5% for postfixed. Moving on to the second part of the brachial plexus. The trunks lie in the lower subclavian part of the posterior triangle of the neck. On the upper cervical region, the C5-C6 roots join to form the upper trunk. In the lower cervical region, the C8 and T1 roots join to form the lower trunk. Whereas in the middle, the C7 root continues as the middle trunk. Next are the divisions, which lie posterior to the clavicle. Portions of the brachial plexus contributed by the antedivisions are colored blue, whereas posterior dark yellow all throughout. Each of the 3 trunks divide into anterior and posterior divisions, all of which however lie posterior to the axillary artery at this stage. The antedivisions of the upper and the middle trunk join to form the lateral cord, but the antedivision of the lower trunk continues distally as the medial cord. This can be easily remembered as lower sounds like loner. Now the posterior divisions of all the 3 trunks join to form the posterior cord. We just saw how the 4th part, that is the cords, are formed from the divisions. They lie in the infraclavicular portion just posterior to the pectoralis minor muscle. In this part, they are named so based on their relation to the axillary artery. So here we can see the axillary artery in the center, the vein is just medial to it. The lateral cord is lateral to the axillary artery, the medial cord medial to it, and the posterior cord posterior to it. Now comes the 5th and the final portion, the terminal branches in the characteristic M shape. The lateral cord continues as the musculocutaneous nerve after giving the lateral root of the median nerve, while the medial cord continues as the ulnar nerve after giving the medial root of the median nerve, which joins the lateral counterpart. The posterior cord divides into a thinner axillary and a thicker radial nerve. MARMU, MARMU is a good mnemonic for the terminal branches. In this line diagram, the motor branches are drawn as solid line, the sensory as dashed line, and sensory motor as mixed solid with dashed line. Note that all the 5 terminal branches, also called peripheral nerves, are mixed sensory motor nerves. Finally, moving on to the side branches, which are 11 in number, 2 in the roots, 2 in the trunks, none in the divisions, and 7 in the cords. The first branch from the root is dorsal scapular, the second is long thoracic. Only the upper trunk gives branches, the first being nerve to subclavius and the suprascapular nerve. The divisions have no branches, the lateral cord gives the lateral pectoral nerve, whereas the medial cord gives the medial pectoral nerve, followed by two cutaneous nerves, the medial cutaneous nerve of arm and forearm. The posterior cord gives three branches, the upper, middle, and lower subscapular nerves. The middle subscapular is also called thoracodorsal nerve. The branches of the posterior cord can be remembered by the mnemonic stars. Note that subscapular comes from the posterior cord, whereas the suprascapular comes from the upper trunk. Also note that out of these 11 side branches, only one, that is the suprascapular nerve, is sensory motor, whereas the medial cutaneous nerve of arm and forearm are sensory. The remaining 8 side branches are pure motor. Though not a part of the brachial plexus, from C3-4-5 comes the phrenic nerve, which also lies in the interscalene triangle and traverses anterior to the scalenus anticus, while from T1 comes the first intercostal nerve. Now that we have a fair idea about the brachial plexus, let's look into some clinically relevant classifications. We know that the divisions are at the level of clavicle. So roots and trunks above the clavicle are classified as supraclavicular, whereas cords and terminal branches infraclavicular. Any injury to the supraclavicular portion of the brachial plexus has poor prognosis and lesser reconstructive options, whereas infraclavicular has better prognosis. Now coming to the roots, C5 and C6 are classified as upper brachial plexus, whereas C8 and T1 lower. When C7 is also involved along with C5 and C6, it's called extended upper brachial plexus palsy. The popular Erb's palsy is a classical example of upper plexus involvement, where the injury is to the upper trunk where C5 and C6 meet. However, upper plexus injuries involve all patterns, like C5 only injury or C5 plus C6 injury. Similarly, Klumke's paralysis is an example of lower plexus involvement where the injury is to the lower trunk. It's interesting to note that as we move from C5 to T1, the deficit pattern moves from the shoulder to the hand. So the upper plexus injury has more involvement of shoulder and elbow, whereas the lower more of wrist and hand. Now, moving on to the origin of the brachial plexus from the spinal cord. Here we can see the vertebral body anteriorly or ventrally and the spine of the vertebra posteriorly or dorsally and the transverse process laterally. In the middle we have the spinal cord with central gray matter having anterior and posterior extensions. From the anterior extensions comes out the ventral motor root, while the posterior extension receives sensory fibers which relay first onto the dorsal root ganglion. This can be easily remembered using the mnemonic V to M, that is ventral motor, and D to S, that is dorsal sensory. Now the sensory and motor fibers join to form the mixed spinal nerve which exits the intervertebral foramen and divides into the ventral rami and the dorsal rami. This ventral rami of the spinal nerve represents the roots of the brachial plexus and shouldn't be confused with the ventral root. The dorsal rami supplies the paravertebral muscles and a strip of midline back skin. We can see the same in the section here. Anterior to the spinal nerve lies the vertebral artery and the vein. Now, apart from the ventral and the dorsal rami, the spinal nerve also gives out white and ray communicantes carrying sympathetic fibers to and from the sympathetic ganglions. Now, closest to T1 is the stellate ganglion. Note that based on the dorsal root ganglion, which has the cell bodies of the peripheral sensory nerves, the brachial plexus can be divided into pre-ganglionic or post-ganglionic. Pre-ganglionic injuries are also called avulsions and have very poor prognosis, whereas post-ganglionic injuries are called ruptures. The upper cervical C4 to C7 roots are held to the transverse process by deep cervical fascia. Also, triangular pyramatar extensions called denticulate ligaments are stronger in the upper cervical vertebra. Hence, upper plexus are less prone to avulsion injuries and more prone to rupture or post-ganglionic injuries, whereas lower plexus are more prone to avulsion or pre-ganglionic injuries with worse prognosis. In pre-ganglionic injuries, due to injury to the ventral root of the spinal nerve, the motor signals to the respective myotomes is interrupted. Also, when T1 root is involved, the sympathetic supply to the stellate ganglion is interrupted and hence Horner syndrome develops. However, since the peripheral sensory fibers continue to relate to their cell bodies in the dorsal root ganglion, the sensory neural action potential on nerve conduction studies continue to be normal. But since the signals fail to reach the brain, the sensations are not perceived. On the other hand, in post-ganglionic ruptures, the motor deficit is similar, but since the sensory fibers are cut distal to the dorsal root ganglion, though the peripheral sensations are interrupted, the nerve fibers from the cut surface through the dorsal root ganglion and spinal cord to the brain is intact, and hence, tingling in the cut surface can be elicited as positive Tinel's sign in the posterior triangle of the neck. Now moving on to myotome or dermatome, which can be defined as a group of muscles with a particular function or the sensations of a portion of the skin respectively, which is supplied by a particular spinal root and distributed through one or more peripheral nerves. Please note that all the muscles of the shoulder girdle and upper limb and also the sensations of the upper limb are supplied by the brachial plexus except trapezius muscle and upper medial arm sensations. So, they help us locate the roots involved in supraclavicular injuries. Like C5 status can be known by testing shoulder abduction, which is brought about by deltoid and supraspinatus, while elbow flexion by brachialis and biceps, and wrist extension by ECRP and ECRL, and also supination by biceps and supinator are brought about mainly by C6 and also C5. C7 is involved in elbow extension by triceps along with C5 and C6 and also wrist flexion by FCR mainly, while C8 is tested by checking finger flexion or power grip, T1 by checking finger abduction by the intrinsics. The confusing opposing action at the wrist and the elbow by C6 and C7 root can be easily sorted by remembering elbow flexion by C6. The rest falls into place, like the action in the wrist by C6 is opposite, that is extension, while C7 causes elbow extension and wrist flexion. Following myotome chart by Merle is regularly used by brachial plexus surgeons for locating the lesion. Note the overlap of myotomes. For the interested, here is a detailed myotomal map of the upper limb. Now moving on to the dermatomes of C5 to T1, the points marked are the most representative points. For C5, it is the mid-lateral portion of the arm. The C6, it's the tip of the thumb. For C7, tip of the index finger more than middle finger. For C8, tip of little finger. For T1, the medial portion of the elbow. The upper medial portion of the arm is not supplied by the brachial plexus, it's by T2. We should not confuse the dermatomes with the cutaneous territories of the peripheral nerves and branches. While the dermatomes are useful in identifying the roots involved in supraclavicular injuries, the cutaneous territories or fields are important in infraclavicular injuries. So now, we are in a really good position to define the brachial plexus, which is a network of nerves that originates from the ventral rami of C5 to T1 spinal nerves, extends from the neck to the axilla, and provides the ipsilateral shoulder and upper limb motor innervation, except the trapezius, which is supplied by accessory spinal nerve, the sensory innervation, except the upper medial arm, which is supplied by the intercostal brachial nerve, that is T2, and autonomic innervation, mainly sympathetic, which is vasomotor, pilomotor, and secretomotor. So, today we have learnt how to easily draw a brachial plexus by knowing three Y's, a cross, oblique line, and a tick, the five parts of the brachial plexus in detail, the 11 side branches of the brachial plexus, how to classify the brachial plexus into supraclavicular and infraclavicular, upper and lower, and also pre- and post-ganglionic. If you wish to learn the topographical distribution of the trunks and the terminal branches, the muscles supplied by each branch and their function, please check out the second part of this tutorial. Please like, subscribe, and share this channel for more similar tutorials. Also, visit us at PlaRecon.com and let us keep learning plastic surgery together.